Professor Thandika Mkandawire, thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
There's been two very different narratives in the last 10 years, probably best seen through the headlines of The Economist magazine. One talking about the hopeless continent, the other talking about Africa rising. Where do you see the truth?
Africans themselves appear to be immune to Afro-pessimism. We now have the risk of a new malady, if you like, an Afro-euphoria, where the good news about Africa is what you read. Just as the Afro-pessimism was misleading, so is the Afro-euphoria misleading. And from what I read, from the Afro-barometer, the Africans themselves are not euphoric about what's going on now. They're not dancing in the streets about the current boom. There is obviously a recovery of African economies. We're seeing quite a substantial increase in incomes. But remember that for some of the countries, they yet have to reach the incomes they had in the 70s. Yes, there is something to celebrate, but one has to remember, one, that many countries have to get back where they were in the 70s. Two, we still have to figure out what are the exact sources of this recovery and which of those are sustainable and which are just one-off.
In this push for economic growth, then, is enough being done and what needs to be done for inclusive, sustainable growth?
Structural adjustment is finally working. This is what you hear from the Washington institutions, and I think the chief economist for Africa in the World Bank actually claimed that finally structural adjustment was working. Now, that would involve a policy that has a huge time lag of 20 years time lag for a policy, and so I wouldn't take that a bit too seriously. But more significantly, I think one can identify, one, an improved terms of trade. Africans do well when terms of trade improve, and this has been an unusually long period of good terms of trade, and fairly widespread over commodities. It's not like the oil boom in the 70s. This is much, it's much broader. The African leadership today, the main source of their legitimacy is economic performance. And virtually every young new leader in Africa talks about the economy. The economy is important. For the first time, you hear African countries talking about rates of growth as important. It was remarkable that the vice president of Kenya, during his inaugural speech, asked the question, why is Ethiopia growing faster than we are growing? And that to me was really a turnaround in African thinking, that they are aware of the neighbor's performance and this peer pressure is building around economies performing well.
What does that awareness, how does it play itself out? How do you see that awareness that governments have towards the importance of economic growth in terms of their policy actions?
Well, they talk a lot about it, for one, which is a big change. I mean, the fact that they themselves point to that as something that marks their rule. In the 60s and 70s, most leaders in Africa would point, if they were proud of anything at all, it would be about keeping the country together. Okay. It was really, the economy was, and perhaps maybe they were justified, keeping the country together was perhaps a very, at that time, the most crucial thing. But today, if look at the debates of the African Union, whenever the heads of state meet, time and again, it's the economy is central. This may also have to do something with the end of the colonial wars and the end of apartheid, which took a lot of time, these Pan-African conferences, it spent a lot of time on thinking about South Africa and liberation movement. But now, it's the economy. Yes, it's the economy.
The economies are clearly central, and those in development will always agree with that. But they will also point to the economic value of investing in women. Do you see an improvement in that in the continent?
Africa is emerging from a regime in which the social policy was marginalized. Most of the institutions that were responsible for social policy are very weak. And unfortunately, also ideologically, there's a whole new generation of leaders who see the economy, I think, in isolation. They're looking at 5% growth rate, 6% growth rate, and they're praised by the press, international press for that. But we really have to find a story that accompanies, a social policy story that accompanies this new growth. If not, it will just break down politically. I mean, we've had high growth rates in the past, like Ivory Coast. For 11 years or something was a miracle economy, but some things were not managed properly, especially with the issues of inclusion and fairness. So any slight crisis that came up kind of just blew up. So I'm worried about this absence of a story about that tries to have a regime that is developmental in terms of its orientation, but at the same time is socially inclusive and, in Africa, democratic.
How critical is it for African governments to ensure that growing youth are engaged into the labour market and hence society?
This youth will react, whether we like it or not. And what movements attract them most will depend on what society at large offers as solutions. Political survival requires that the youth are engaged in a constructive way in the new African project, which means Africa must invest massively in education, massively. Although the university population is growing rapidly, there are very serious debates about quality of these institutions.
Which is the same across the board, no?
I mean, primary school
education,
yes.
Enrolment, massively up.
Exactly.
But what are children learning quality, when they sit at their desk? Yes. The extractive industries, oil, gas, and so on. To what degree is that a large part of the economic growth, or is there a much bigger story behind Africa's economic growth?
Well, two figures are often given. One is that, of course, the mining industry is growing, and one is service sector is growing. The big problem is that manufacturing is not growing. That's a big headache. And the mining industry happens to be capital intensive, so it's not a great employer. The service sector employs a lot of people, but these are bad jobs, they're poorly paid jobs normally. So although it looks like a service sector is expanding, it's not the same thing as the service sector expanding in Europe. You know, this is the service sector expanding in the informal sector and greater informalization and all that. So the two poles of this growth are not very healthy, you know, because we're not doing very well in manufacturing. And in fact, the media, when they write about Africa, quite remarkable, they don't talk of Africans as producers, as workers, they talk as consumers. Obviously, you can't sustain growth by simply consuming. You have to invest and you have to produce. And when people talk about China, you don't talk about China really as a consumer. You talk about China as a world factory, as a producer. So there is just be aware that manufacturing is not doing well, and therefore there are no jobs being created in the urban areas.
You've been a development economist for 40 years. How do you see the next 10 or 20?
Look, in the next 20 years, for the first time in Africa's long history, the population, the majority will be urban. And the urban pressures are very specific. You have to produce jobs and the economy must move. And that will be very, very, very powerful. And I think the demographics, if we manage to invest in education, are favorable, very, very favorable. And the resource base is good. Africa has a very good resource base. If those hold on together, I see no reason why Africa should not do well. It turns out Africa, by the way, democracy does well for African economies. So in Africa, we just have to think of not the Asian authoritarian developmental state, but to think of a democratic developmental state. And we have lessons within Africa itself that we can draw from. And I can see, and democracy turns out in Africa tend to perform better than dictatorships.
Professor Mkandawire, thank you very much.
Thank you.